again, 678-447-2012. Tell them you heard it on Power 108.9. What up, Credit Crit?
Question, who has an idea for a new app? Well, if you answer yes to that question, it's time for you to holler at our friends over at Appsketeers. Yo, it's Michael McFadden of Power 108.9 and the crew over at Appsketeers to take great care of you. Nick and the gang provide you with the all-in-one app development experience. We're talking design, UI, UX, coding, and a whole bunch more. And if you have no clue what that means, it's time for you to holler at Appsketeers. Check out the website, appsketeers.com. Now, we're talking full confidentiality, no hassle, no obligation. If you don't believe me, just call them. 833-APP-IDEA. That's 833-APP-IDEA. As a matter of fact, you know what they do? They design, they build, and they launch. Tell them you heard it on Power 108.9. And don't forget to ask for the governor. What up, Nick? Yo, looking for a new house? Then it's time for you to holler at our guy, the mortgage guy, Alvin Jameson of Loan Depot. Yo, it's your boy Michael McFadden of Mornings with Michael and Friends, and I tell you what, Alvin Jameson and the crew, they really do it all. First-time home buyers, refinances, investment properties, VA home loans too. Hit them up. It's very simple. AlvinJameson.com. Y'all know Alvin like the chipmunk, Jameson like that fine whiskey. You can also hit him up by mobile phone, 404-587-9033. Once again, 404-587-9033. Alvin Jameson, Loan Depot. Tell him you heard it on Power 108.9. What up, Alvin?
Is there a family member or friend that you are aware of that is suffering in silence when it comes to her cycle? Justice for My Jewel has a new product that will minimize the cramps and kill 99.6% of the bacteria so that it effectively eliminates odor. The Justice for My Jewel campaign is about reducing these numbers through awareness and education. Please join their campaign and share this information with the women in your life at jfmj.org. For more information and to order today, go to painlesschoice.com or contact the Three Amigos at 470-387-1675. You will be comfortable and dry. The suffering in silence stops today, and tell them Syndy B sent them your way.
Keep up with Power 108.9 on social media. Instagram
at Power 108.9
and Facebook
at Power 108.9.
It's the exact same thing. It's at Power 108.9.
Oh, okay.
Power 108.9, a station for the people. If you hadn't made your way over to Power 108.9.com, you're just as bad as the people who didn't vote in this year's election.
The votes are still coming in. I'm going to give you a list of states that I'm never visiting, ever.
Oh, never, ever, ever.
F*** y'all state. I'm sorry, did I just cut?
I
dropped the F-bomb, didn't I?
Straight. My early bad. In the morning.
Power 108.9, a station for the people. In a world of petty and immature people, it's refreshing to hear a morning show that has sophisticated hosts such as Michael McFadden and Jay Nash. Don't believe me? Take a listen.
But shout out to our friends over there at Credit Building Professionals. What up, Credit Crit?
I tried to come with you.
Yeah, thank you very much. That's what she said.
Oh.
Hey. Power 108.9, a station for the people.
Yeah. The Unbroken Experience with Syndy B. You know what it be. Yeah, you heard it all before. I love you so
cheers, much. Cheers. We are here, and that means it is Thursday, and you are listening to the Unbroken Experience with Syndy B on Power 108.9. We have a great show lined up for you today. Today's topic is Family Matters, Breaking the Silence. So much happens within a family dynamic. We're going to try our best to cover a few issues, traditions, cultural things, all of that kind of fun stuff in our Family Matters conversation. Of course, you know we have that 7:30 crazy lined up for you at the 7:30 hour, and that What Would Sin Say at the top of the 8 o'clock hour, And my girl, your favorite Truth No Chaser co-host, Miss Natalie Fikes. She's back in the building. Say hey to the people.
Hey to the people.
And I have to give a shout out to my little mini me, my little minion. Happy birthday, Sin-Sin. She is 9 today.
Go, Sinya. It's your birthday.
Happy birthday, Sin-Sin. And my nephew's birthday, my very first nephew, the one who made me an auntie first. I don't know how old he is, maybe like 25, 26. Terrell, you know, I can't keep up.
That's a grown man.
My nephew, and he's like 6'4", towering over me, and he's still my little baby. And happy birthday to my grandma in heaven. Her birthday's on the 17th. Happy birthday, grandma. All right, so we've got this whole conversation. We're going to try our best. We're gonna cover it. We're gonna put the family business out there.
Listen.
We have to do better in our conversations and our communications within our family. So that is the point of tonight. So make sure you stay tuned in. Please share if you are hearing my voice. Please share the love and spread the love. Just don't keep it to yourself. And make sure you stay tuned in. You are listening to The Unbroken Experience with Syndy B on Power 108.9. And we'll be right back.
Is there a family member or friend that you are aware of that is suffering in silence when it comes to her cycle? Justice for My Jewel has a new product that will minimize the cramps and kill 99.6% of the bacteria so that it effectively eliminates odor. The Justice for My Jewel campaign is about reducing these numbers through awareness and education. Please join their campaign and share this information with the women in your life at jfmj.org. For more information and to order today, go to painlesschoice.com or contact the Three Amigos at 470-387-1675. You will be comfortable and dry. The suffering in silence stops today. And tell them Syndy B sent them your way.
If you hadn't made your way over to power108.9.com, you're just as bad as the people who didn't vote in this year's election.
The votes are still coming in. I'm going to give you a list of states that I'm never visiting, ever.
Oh, never, ever, ever.
F*** y'all state. I'm sorry, did I just cut?
You just cut.
I dropped the F-bomb, didn't I?
Straight. Early in the morning.
Power 108.9, a station for the people. What's up, family? I call you family because I feel like we can be honest with each other. Nowadays, we all got side hustles and businesses. And in a gig economy, we're all looking for ways to expand our clientele. Power up with 108.9's advertising partnership. Connect to over 100,000 viewers per month. If you're interested, contact our marketing director at thepower108.9@gmail.com. Help us reach your target audience and expand your brand. Power 108.9, the station for the people.
Welcome back. You're listening to The Unbroken Experience with Syndy B on Power 108.9. I've got my girl, my co-host in the building, Miss Natalie Fikes. Get the people a shout out.
What's up, people in the house? Natalie Fikes in the building. Everybody know I don't got to rhyme with the building because I'm Natalie Fikes. She wasn't ready.
I'm like, wait, what happened?
Scratch!
Oh my gosh. Okay. So we ready to talk about the family matters.
Let's go.
Not the family matters that we used to watch growing up with Urkel.
Whatever happened to predictability? The milkman, the paperboy, the evening TV.
Not that kind of family matters. No. Mm-mm. The real deal. You know, we've been trying to talk about this for a minute, mm-hmm. and we've kind of had it in conjunction with a different topic, and really not been able to expand on it as much. Mm-hmm. Why we want to talk about that today?
It's that it's a stronghold. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? It's just something that our jawbone isn't wired to do. It's almost like, don't cross the gun line, boss.
Oh, why?
I mean, I've crossed the gun line, and I realized that there's no boss. Mm-hmm. So, you know what I'm saying? We're in a different world now, mm-hmm. but we've been so programmed that what happens in the house stays in the house, stay at a grown folk business, stay in a child's place. But we're grown now.
Yeah.
And we have our own families. But because there weren't rules of engagement then that were healthy, now we have these families and we're just continuing a cycle that.
So I have a question. With that whole stay in a child's place, stay out of grown folks' business, what are your thoughts on that? Because you know us, we heard that a lot growing up. Mm-hmm. And just kind of piggybacking off what you just said, it's like children, in my opinion, it was almost like we weren't real people.
Right. No, absolutely. And so it's stay out of grown folks' business, stay in a child's place, and a child is to be seen and not heard. That's one of the worst.
Crazy.
But we have to go back.
Okay.
Back in time. Right? Oh, baby.
Right.
And so the people who raised us, mm-hmm. oh my gosh, shout out to, I'm not built for what they went through.
Right.
They're coming out of depression. Mm-hmm. They're first, second generation outside of slavery and types of things like that. Mm-hmm. So let's think about the foundation specifically for the Black community. Mm-hmm. When you're whipped and you're working all day long, and this is what your children were born into the family. You were humping so that, not out of love, mm-hmm. but so that you could get somebody to help you pick this cotton.
Dang.
And help you work
the land.
Mm-hmm. There's no, oh, I had you in love. And you understand? So then
that kind of explains the separation
between
an adult and a child. And why subconsciously that was passed down, you know, from generation to mm-hmm. generation, where a child is to be seen and not heard.
You know what you're here for? Just do that. Don't come over here trying to get your emotions fulfilled and la-di-da-di. What is that?
Okay.
Love.
Right. You don't know nothing about love.
Right. We don't got time for that. And that's not what this is about. Right? It's survival. Mm-hmm. Everybody in the family is playing their part. Mm-hmm. Mama gonna lay down and take this, mm-hmm. right? So that we could pop out these kids, so we could get some help, so that maybe Massa, mm-hmm. you know, it's the psychology behind it.
I was watching an episode of Iyanla, and it had, I can't think of the girl's name. If I said her name, you might know who it is. She was on originally, Flavor of Love back in the day, and then she was on Love and Hip Hop Atlanta, and then Miami. Gosh, I can't think of her name right now. I know her brother. Her brother MJ, he used to be in my house. We were signed to the same label. Amazing singer. So she, MJ, and they have an older brother and their mom. So they had it just based on the conversation we're having now. They're grown now. And they're crying in this session because they didn't receive love from their mother.
Mm-hmm.
Dad was gone. He was present, but, you know, it was a bad split or whatever. So they were mainly with mom. And mom was surviving.
Mm-hmm.
So mom, you know, told the fellas, you know, don't be no punk.
Mm-hmm.
You know, don't be no punk. You handle this and you handle that. And it was just tough love mm-hmm. all day. Not realizing that your boys, mm-hmm. your daughter too, but your boys also needed love from their mother. They needed that nurturing. They needed mm-hmm. to hear. They said they didn't even hear her say, "I love you."
Right.
And I know, you know, teaching in the schools and things, I see children and you can tell that they have not heard the words, I love you.
Yeah, it was for the time. Mm-hmm. That's why it's so important for us to be having conversations like this, because the times have changed.
Right.
We always say, they fought and they build and on the backs of people and all that. And it's like, absolutely. But guess what?
We don't have to do that.
We won. Right. It's almost like the reason why we can't have fulfillment is like we never get there. Mm-hmm. How will you ever be fulfilled if there's never a period? Mm-hmm. There's a never, we close that book. We have overcome. Like we have literally, we're still fighting and struggling and surviving. Right. We don't have to do that anymore. But this generation, they're not here for it.
Let me tell you something. They are definitely not here for it. At all. So let's go back to a child's place, right? Let's go back to a child's place. How does that show up? You have two boys.
Mm-hmm.
How does that show up in your home in terms of, are they in a child's place or how does the communication? I mean, I know how it goes, but tell people.
Well, so I had to sit with that because where exactly is a child's place. It's like, stay in a child's place. And it's like,
where that at?
Where exactly do you find that on the map? You know what I'm saying? Right. So I went and I looked for it.
Okay.
And I said, okay, well, this is my family now. Mm-hmm. Where is the child's place? And so I realized that the child's place is a seat at the table. Mm-hmm. I had to sit and think about what I needed when I was a child. Mm-hmm. You are making decisions that affect me, but you are not including me in the conversation. You are not communicating with me about anything to take into consideration how your decision may affect me in some sort of way because you haven't slowed down to get to know me.
Yeah.
And so I got to know my children. Oh, God. Two totally different people. I was an only child for 13 years, so it should have been easier. Mm-hmm. But when you got two and three different, four, five, six different personalities of people and you haven't gotten to know them, somebody's being left behind. And so a child's place is a seat at the table where you're saying, look, we're thinking about, I know that you've been used to a bunch of people being in the house or you've been used to mom and dad being here or you've been used to XYZ, but this is about to happen. Mm-hmm. And so we just wanted to first let you know so you don't wake up in the middle of the night and there's a moving truck.
Sure, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But also we need to communicate through this because everyone is going through a change and that's what, I mean, that's why people can't deal with change now because we never talk about it. It just happens and it's like trauma.
Yeah.
That's where we get it from.
Absolutely. You know what? When it comes to the way that it seems like we're raising our children now, I like that you said that two totally different children, number one. And what, an uncomfortable place for me is when I have my children who I communicate with. I actually have conversations with them. I communicate with them. I let them know what's going on. I allow them to have a voice.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I am the final decision maker.
Right.
Okay. But that doesn't mean that they have no input, no opinion, no feelings, no nothing. And it's very important that we acknowledge those and we know what they are by asking their input.
So what's dope about what you just said is that because I believe that relationships are it's the foundation of everything, right?
Yes.
And I honestly have been like the best business person because of my children, like literally, because what you just said was, I am the final decision maker. I'm the CEO of the situation.
Yes.
However, I am taking into consideration the input of my employees who are in the ground. They're at the baseline of everything. They're the recipients of all things that happen.
Right.
And they're saying to me, Mom, and I'm like, I never thought about that. And they have a it affected so many of the decisions that I have made.
Yes.
I take into consideration everything that I do and how it's going to affect them based upon the feedback that they've given me.
Yeah.
And I always think about that when dealing with other people. Like, Natalie, you might think this might be good for you because that's how you're built.
Right.
And this is what you can take care of. I'm like, look, no matter what, we're good. We're going to be good. And right. then they're sitting here like, I'm not built like that.
Right. Exactly. And you know what? When we don't acknowledge that when they're children, they internalize that.
Oh, yeah.
And then that carries over into their adulthood. Hmm. And we'll get into all of that and how our childhood affects, you know, our adulthood, you know, at some point. But they carry that. And then we wonder why we don't know how to maintain friendships.
Mm-hmm.
We wonder why we don't know how to collaborate with our our peers at work, our colleagues and things like that. Because we weren't able to communicate as children and work through
mm-hmm.
our thought process, work through how our personalities fit within our environment. One of the, when I was saying the uncomfortable points is when I have my children around my aunties.
The ones that raised you.
The ones that raised me, mm-hmm. yes. And to me, when I hear, if I say, have a seat, it's time to eat. And they're like, okay, what's for dinner? And I'm like, fried rice and beans, mm-hmm. you know.
Yeah.
And they're like, I don't like that.
Yeah. The aunties is like,
okay, you should
beat them.
Beat them down.
Hang them outside. You're disrespectful, for nothing type of brother.
Disrespectful. And when I see their faces at the fact that sometimes I'm like, well, that's what we have.
That's what it is
tonight. Okay. Or, but sometimes I might be like, well, we have something else. You know, what is it that
right.
you want? You
yeah.
know? Because if that's it, then that ain't nothing I can do about that. But if we got an option, why they can't have an option?
Listen, what's so funny about this is that, because I always say, like, when I'm talking to parents, I'm like, you know that some of your kids could cook better than you.
Yeah.
And they sitting here eating this dry chicken.
Right.
And instead of tagging the stronger teammate in, they sitting there.
Ooh,
chewing on that chicken.
Listen, and my mommy is listening. My mommy, you know, she can cook, and she had the dishes that I love, right? But there with these, mommy, if you listening, I can't think of what you call these biscuits.
These are my confessions.
But my mommy would make these biscuits right from scratch. The biscuits itself were good, right?
Mm-hmm.
But you know, so you know how you make the hole, and then you take out all the biscuits and these little pockets and these. So she would cut those and make those into biscuits, but they're not fluffy. They weren't fluffy.
Right.
But we got all of those. We didn't get the biscuits.
the fluff.
We got the, you know, like, we're not going to throw anything away. Like, we're not going to waste it. And I used to hate those.
Yes.
And here we go. There's no fluffiness to it. Like, the biscuit part that she actually
cooked. I am not enjoying this experience.
It's like crunch. Crunch, you know?
And as a kid, like, you literally, we have to step into a kid's experience, right? You know, we try to act as adults like we got everything figured
together,
out.
Right,
you know,
right,
we
right.
don't have Not everything together.
All.
Hardly 50% for real, right? And so these kids who were born for the generation to precede us,
yes.
right? They're looking at us like, well, okay. But they really have the answers,
yes,
right? And
yes.
so they're like, I know the biscuit should be fluffy. However, mom has worked really hard
right.
all day. And I know, I'm pretty sure, because she's amazing at other things, that there is a purpose for this flatbread
right.
biscuit that we had.
Oh, my God.
And so we don't tag them in. And I think it's so unfair that we don't take into consideration the effects of our decisions, the effects of our inabilities
mm-hmm.
that we try to camouflage, that it is somebody is the receiver, the recipient.
My mama said they were called pony jacks. And she said, and she said they were good too. Okay, mommy.
Right.
Yes,
and that's exactly where it was. Yes, ma'am. Crunch, crunch. You know, at the end of the day, I want a fluffy biscuit. Can I get
I
a fluffy
want the biscuit? The round one, mama.
And you know what? Then Syndy grows up and says, my kids will never have.
Ever.
You going to have the fluffiest
one in the pan, okay?
And oh we set the bar for our kids that you will not have the same experience that not I had.
And you know, and just even just continuing on that, you know, we had to eat what was there. And growing up, I hated onions and peppers. And onions and peppers were on everything. The eggs, the burger. No, I love onions and peppers now in my eggs. But growing up, here I go picking them out. And now I can't, on a pizza.
Girl.
Can I taste the pizza? I taste is onion and pepper.
They used to, it was, you don't leave the table. Now, I'm Jamaican, too. So we got Jamaican, New York, and a child is supposed to be seen. Hey, I heard staying, all of that on one. And so, porridge, right?
Right.
And I tell my kids this now. I was like, if you don't like it, don't judge it. Because mommy may not be the best at that. Always try it one time.
Yes.
And try it one time in every different experience. Because some people just know how to burn. And you know, man, I now grew up to understand that it wasn't that I didn't like porridge. I ain't like yo porridge. And so when I was hearing the story of Goldilocks, and she would have the three different porridges.
She's like, ooh, no, that
ooh,
ain't it. Ooh, but this one this is. One right here. Listen, when we come back, I want to, is it 7:30? Oh, my gosh. Okay, so when we come back, it is time for that 7:30 crazy. And then after that, we are going to touch into family secrets. I ain't going to tell the business. But that's what we talking about.
I'm telling the business.
Why? Who are we hiding from? Please tell me.
Hey, Chester. We coming for you, Chester.
Listen, make sure you stay tuned in and share. You're listening to The Unbroken Experience with Syndy B on Power 108.9, and we'll be right back.
Is there a family member or friend that you are aware of that is suffering in silence when it comes to her cycle? Justice for My Jewel has a new product that will minimize the cramps and kill 99.6% of the bacteria so that it effectively eliminates odor. The Justice for My Jewel campaign is about reducing these numbers through awareness and education. Please join their campaign and share this information with the women in your life at jfmj.org. For more information and to order today, go to painlesschoice.com or contact the Three Amigos at 470-387-1675. You will be comfortable and dry. The suffering in silence stops today. And tell them Syndy B sent them your way.
Yo, looking for a new house? Then it's time for you to holler at our guy, the mortgage guy, Alvin Jameson of Loan Depot. Yo, it's your boy Michael McFadden of Mornings with Michael and Friends. And I tell you what, Alvin Jameson and the crew, they really do it all. First-time home buyers, refinances, investment properties, VA home loans too. Hit them up. It's very simple. AlvinJameson.com. Y'all know Alvin like the chipmunk. Jameson like that fine whiskey. You can also hit him up by mobile phone. 404-587-9033. Once again, 404-587-9033. Alvin Jameson, Loan Depot. Tell them you heard it on Power 108.9. What up, Alvin?
Keep up with Power 108.9 on social media.
How can I find you?
Instagram.
At Power 108.9.
And Facebook.
At Power 108.9.
It's the exact same thing. It's at Power 108.9.
Power 108.9, a station for the people. Keep up with Power 108.9 on social media.
How can I find you?
Instagram.
At Power 108.9.
And Facebook.
At Power 108.9.
It's the exact same thing. It's at Power 108.9.
Oh. Okay.
Power 108.9, a station for...
Here we go.
Call me crazy one more time.
Laughing while he does it. He turns to me and he says,
"Why so serious?"
Boy, you're so crazy.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
You ain't seen no sign of him being crazy, deranged.
Welcome back. You're listening to The Unbroken Experience with Syndy B on Power 108.9. It is time for that 7:30 crazy. You ready?
Yes.
All right, speaking of family matters. All right, this is from the Jasmine brand. Real Housewives of Salt Lake City, Mary Cosby, defends marrying, ready, her late grandmother's husband.
Oh, please.
We're not, she says, we're not blood. Mary Cosby already has viewers intrigued about her personal life, specifically her marriage. The new reality star is married to her late grandmother's husband, Robert C. Cosby, who is 62. Which in turn, I don't know if it says how old she is, I'm not sure, which in turn entitled her to inherit multiple successful family businesses. In a recent interview, Mary Cosby justified her marriage and said that Robert Cosby is not her blood and it was a family situation that she felt was right. She also adds that it is not considered incest to her and her family and that she stands on keeping her grandmother's empire together. Mary Cosby is 47 and he is 62. When Mary's grandmother Rosemary died of a heart attack in 97, her net worth from ownership of churches, properties, and homes was reportedly in the millions. She inherited her family's empire of churches and other properties after she married the man her grandmother left the empire to. Her cast member said that Mary is a Pentecostal first lady who inherited her family's empire of churches, restaurants, and more. The caveat in her taking over the family business was that she married her late grandmother's second husband, Robert Cosby Sr. They have been married. They have since been married for 20 years and have one teenage son together. All right, Ms. Natalie Fikes, is Miss Mary Cosby marrying her late grandmother's husband 7:30 crazy or no?
I don't think so.
Okay, explain.
I don't think so. So it's very layered.
Okay.
And the fact that we put it all together makes it juicy.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Yes.
But if we take it apart,
uh-huh,
I don't think that is 7:30 crazy. I think actually it could be very strategic, right? And the fact that they've been married for 20 years counts for something.
Yes.
That's one. But people could be married for 20 years and it still be a whole, whatever. And then, you know, Michael McFadden and them, they say, you know, it's business, you know. So everybody has their own thing. At the end of the day, there is no right or wrong. There's only conviction. And so if you riding granddaddy and granddaddy is hubby and you all good, bust a nut.
Hey,
do your thing.
Hey.
Get your thing on.
Yes. Okay, so I agree with Natalie. I don't think it's 7:30 crazy. You know, people need to marry more for a purpose.
Say my name again.
Natalie Fine.
You know, she said, I agree with Natalie.
That was not intentional. I'm a very bad actress. But no, I don't think it's 7:30 crazy. I think people need to be more intentional about why they marry these days.
Yeah. It's a new world,
you know? And they've been making it work. So, hey, it is what it is. It's not 7:30 crazy to me, y'all.
Not over
or
here.
Or Natalie Fikes.
Hey, granddaddy. I'm waiting.
Granddaddy. But let me know in the comments whether you think it's 7:30 crazy or not. Make sure you stay tuned in and share. You're listening to The Unbroken Experience with Syndy B on Power 108.9. And we'll be right back.
Is there a family member or friend that you are aware of that is suffering in silence when it comes to her cycle? Justice for My Jewel has a new product that will minimize the cramps and kill 99.6% of the bacteria so that it effectively eliminates odor. The Justice for My Jewel campaign is about reducing these numbers through awareness and education. Please join their campaign and share this information with the women in your life at jfmj.org. For more information and to order today, go to painlesschoice.com or contact the Three Amigos at 470-387-1675. You will be comfortable and dry. The suffering in silence stops today, and tell them Syndy B sent them your way.
Yo, it's Michael McFadden for our friends over at Credit Building Professionals. You know what they do? They help their clients achieve better credit. How? Late payments, fraud, liens, charge-offs, student loans. They do it all. Get results in 30 to 90 days, and it's very simple to contact them. Hit them up on their website, creditbuildingprofessionals.com, or give them a call, 678-447-2012. Once again, 678-447-2012. Tell them you heard it on Power 108.9. What up, Credit Craig?
Question, who has an idea for a new app? Well, if you answer yes to that question, it's time for you to holler at our friends over at Appsketeers. Yo, it's Michael McFadden of Power 108.9, and the crew over at Appsketeers will take great care of you. Nick and the gang provide you with the all-in-one app development experience. We're talking design, UI, UX, coding, and a whole bunch more. And if you have no clue what that means, it's time for you to holler at Appsketeers. Check out the website, appsketeers.com. Now, we're talking full confidentiality, no hassle, no obligation. If you don't believe me, just call them, 833-APP-IDEA. That's 833-APP-IDEA. As a matter of fact, you know what they do? They design, they build, and they launch. Tell them you heard it on Power 108.9. And don't forget to ask for the governor. What up, Nick?
I don't want nobody else.
Welcome back. You're listening to The Unbroken Experience with Syndy B on Power 108.9. And I've got my girl, Miss Natalie Fikes, my co-host. Say hey to the people.
Yeah. Arriba, arriba.
I cannot. Yeah, turn that off. We don't want to get cut off. All right. So our topic tonight is family matters, breaking the silence. All right. So speaking of silence, you know, there's a whole lot of secrets that happens in our families. Why the secrets?
So, again, let's go back in time, right? Is that you come from slavery.
Okay.
Where you're watching your wife, your mother, your sister, your cousin be raped and beaten and all of these things. And you're not supposed to say anything. Because if you say something, then you get raped and beaten and all that stuff, right? So now when we're free, all we know is what we know. And so
subconsciously,
you have your family, all that other stuff. And it's like you don't know anything but what you know. That is your normal. And so when the brothers are going through puberty and they little ta-tang, ta-tang standing up, and then now they turn around and start doing that to boys and girls.
Okay.
It's normal. And when daddy is beating mommy, it's normal because that's what massa used to do. It is oppression. it is societal norm for that time. Mm-hmm. It wasn't like we got free and they were like, we have personal development classes now to break you of your oppression. Sign up here. It was not the normal. And so the secret has always been the secret is that I either was the recipient of bad behavior or I watched something take place and that's the normal.
Yeah. You know, I can get with that. I can definitely get with that. But then on the flip side, you know, as we're coming into this generation and you have our generation who we don't know some of the stories that took place in our family that could explain a lot, right? So, and then you've got the, you know, us, some people, you know, passing that down onto the next generation. And, but I don't, you know, I'm, you know, like I've talked about, well, I can only share what I know, right? With my children, you know, I come from a complex family dynamic. And I have told my children exactly my family dynamic. One, because I want them to know who my mom and daddy is, right? They know who their abuela is, right? My biological mother. But I also, you know, made it very clear so that they don't process it in their head the wrong way. They're like, okay, but this is your birth mom, but Queenie is my grandma. That's your, I'm
and
so
that's not
confused.
Fair. That's not fair to a child. Yeah. That's why it's important for us to communicate with them, because think about a child's brain.
Yeah.
We made a lot of decisions about things. Mm-hmm. I will never, this will never, this is that. Mm-hmm. We made a lot of decisions with a child's brain.
Yeah.
So imagine not communicating with your child.
Absolutely.
About something that is they it was it affected them.
Absolutely.
And they're putting that together. And one thing about a child, oh gosh, a child is always defending and protecting and trying to make the adults in their life right.
Yes, right. Or and I have seen children try to comfort.
Yes. And that's not a child's place.
They don't even understand what they're doing, but they're doing it.
That I know is not a child's place.
Yeah. Yeah.
I have not been able to identify on the map where a child's place is.
But that ain't it.
I know for sure.
I remember, I'm in a co-parenting scenario with my son. And I had a conversation with him. I told him the truth just because I didn't want him to play the victim. And so, you know, one day he was having a conversation with me like, you know, I have to go between two homes, blah, 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 blah. And I said, first of all, you are blessed to have two fathers in your life that really love you and really care about you when there are children out here who
don't have one,
number one. I said, number two, I said, your mother was in the same situation except for my biological mother all the way left. I said, do you see me out here whining and complaining? You know, just having conversations like that. Sometimes you think because they're a certain age that they can't handle it, mm-mm. But it really clears up a lot. And it sometimes puts a lot. I remember telling him that and he was like, wait, what? You know, and to see him, you could see the understanding.
Come through his let me tell you something. Let me tell you something we don't understand. And I am very absolutely clear that, and this is based upon my belief and how I live my life spiritually, mm-hmm. is that I serve a God that is generational.
Yes.
Right? Mm-hmm. And so it's like, you know, when you're like, I got plan A, B, C, and D, mm-hmm. that's what our children are.
Yeah.
It's like, I have planted something in Natalie. But if Natalie doesn't fulfill it, mm-hmm. I got Elijah,
right.
I got Jaden,
right,
you know
right,
what I'm
right,
saying?
Right, right.
And so when I think about that, I'm like, I am absolutely clear mm-hmm. that they know more than I do for this time. Mm-hmm. And I certainly know that they know more about themselves
right.
than I do.
Right.
I always tell my kids, can you please set me up for the win?
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Like, we're on the team. You have the blueprint called you.
Right.
But if you don't communicate with me, you're not setting me up to win.
Yes.
I literally want to get this right.
Yeah.
But if you don't communicate with me and say, no, that's a no. Yeah. Or I don't like that. Or that's not okay. Or you see her. Mm-mm. I saw the way she looked.
Yeah.
Those type of things. I won't win.
Yes.
Right?
Right.
So with that in mind and knowing that God is like, look, you were supposed to have been a whole Broadway star and all these other things, but mom didn't know, mm-hmm. so she didn't know how to water that seed. Mm-hmm. I see it popping up in another child.
Right,
and
right.
I'm like, wait a minute. This isn't about me right now. Mm-hmm. This is me for, like, side piece, for fun.
Sure.
But him? He's the one you need to learn, you need to figure it out for this one. And yes. for this one,
yeah.
This, you know, yeah. so it's being a parent
is exhausting. First God. Of all. First of all, I remember having a conversation with someone and I was like, my children are my number one stressors. And that has nothing to do with what I will do for them. How much I love them, how much I need them, how much I enjoy being around them, blah, blah, blah. They are my number one stressor because I parent intentionally. I am an intentional parent. They are just not my children. I'm just not their mom. You know, just well, go do this, go do that, da, 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 da. Mm-hmm. Like, I think about their personalities every single day. Mm-hmm. I think about if I respond like this, what does that do down the line?
To this one. And then there's a whole nother one.
Yes, Michael.
Can I just add?
Yes.
96.4735% of me and Tasha's arguments when the kids were at home mm-hmm. were about the kids.
Wow. Absolutely.
They were the stressors.
Number one stressor. Because I think about me as a child. I think about some of the resentment that I had to let go as a child, one of them where I felt like I didn't need spankings. Mm-hmm. I felt like I didn't need a whooping. Mm-hmm. My, you know, but I got them, mm-hmm. right? And I felt like I got them, one, it was the norm, you know, in our generation,
it
right?
Sure was.
But to me, the way that my mind was set up, if my parent was disappointed in me, it broke me down. Mm-hmm. Like that right there, I felt like I got whooped. You know, but when I got whooped for just growing pains and learning, you know, things, and I felt like I was a good kid, but I got whooped, you know, and I'm especially, you know, when I'm doing good in school, my last whooping, believe it or not, was when I was 15 years old. I still haven't gotten over it, Ma. Sorry, Ma, but I still haven't gotten over it because I remember during that time, I mean, I was loaded with honors classes and AP courses and
else I got to do?
Yeah, you know, and this particular class that I did lie. I lied because it was a math class. It was like advanced geometry or advanced trigonometry or something like that, which I was very good in math. And I think this was when I was getting over double pneumonia and I was coming back. It was something mm-hmm. along those lines, and I had so much work to mm-hmm. make up. And this one, I was like, I couldn't study. You know, with those kind of courses, you got to know the formula.
Best.
You got to know the formula. If you don't know the formula, you shot, right? So I didn't have time. I remember not having time to study. But I knew even if I failed, it doesn't affect my A.
Right.
So I'm like, let me do this, whatever. And I think I got maybe a D. Maybe I failed it. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
It was a quiz. And my mom works downstairs. And because
that grade came through,
bing! And I did, you know, to be straight up, I lied about it to my mom because I just knew it wasn't going to affect my grade, and I don't even want it to be a deal.
Right.
I had enough else to worry about.
Right.
But because it was not the norm,
right.
My teacher came downstairs and said, "Is everything all right with Syndy?" Mm-hmm. And so she told her, and now mommy knows
it's a thing.
And she asked me again, and now she's feeling like I lied to her face.
Right, right.
You know, and all of that. And I got beat down so bad. And then I don't want to say beat because I know mama watched. She's like, I ain't beat you, you know. But, you know.
But did she beat you?
To me, I felt like it was a beating, you know. And I was more embarrassed because my uncle, my godfather was there. And then I had to go and sit at the table and eat. you know, right after that.
The whole experience,
you know. And yeah. I remember, I think I talked to my mommy about that when I was an adult, you know, how it affected me because I felt like I was a good kid.
Yeah.
And I was working hard and I had a lot of stress.
And I was sick.
Getting over and just, I don't necessarily remember if it was that time or not, but what I do know is that I was an honor student. Yeah. That's what I do know.
Right, right.
You know, and a good kid and all of that. And it's like, dang, I deserve all that. And, you know, this is the part where you continue to protect, right? And I'm going to continue to do that because those are my parents. But, you know, I look at it like the stress that a parent, you know, goes through, you know, at the time. And I know what you're about to say. I know what you're about to say. And I can't help myself.
And so for me, that's the issue. That's what we have to break through for. And I know for a fact that no parent, let me tell you something. The time that our parents grew up in, I could break down right now. Mm-hmm. It was not an easy time for them to go through.
Right.
And then to be raising some, we Syndy B's and Natalie Fikes. Right. We was them back then.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. That was a lot to be dealing with at that time. Right. And so, but what I know, because I'm a parent now, I always think about my kids sitting on somebody's couch. Mm-hmm. Because as coaches, the stuff that these grown folks be going through, mm-hmm. I know for sure that I don't want my kids to carry anything
that I put on them.
Oh no. Yeah. That to me is failure as a parent. Yes. That you got enough that you got to deal with on your own to figure out to carry my stuff.
Life about to give you a lot.
I literally ask my kids on a weekly basis, is your childhood good? Mm-hmm. Is there something about your childhood that we need to talk about? And I asked my son that one time, and what came up was like, so my oldest son, when he has been carrying this thing, like he's slow or stupid or something is wrong with him.
Okay.
Because he was held back.
Okay.
In the first grade.
Oh, wow.
And so as stuff was coming up, and the way he was showing up, I was like, why are you presenting yourself mm-hmm. as though something is wrong with you? Mm-hmm. You are a man of great intelligence mm-hmm. and stuff. Something is disconnected from me.
Tell that story, because I remember a video I think you posted or he posted where he spilled his drink. And he was like, I don't need nothing to drink, Mom.
Yes.
And you were telling him, why are you being so hard on yourself?
Yes. It's like he punishes himself. And this thing where it's like he's not smart. And I remember because two people raised me. One is Forrest Gump's mother.
Okay. Okay.
Never let nobody make you feel. And you don't let nobody make a cripple out of you. Like, mm-hmm. they literally mm-hmm. raised me as a parent because I was not mothered mm-hmm. and I was not fathered. Mm-hmm. I just wasn't, okay? And so I always remember that. And I remembered being brought in as a parent and being told that my son needed an IEP. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And something didn't click for me because I was like, he's in, like, pre-pre-K.
Okay.
So I'm trying to figure out, like he still wants to play, right? You know? And they're like, get him tested and all that. I said, I will not get my son tested. And they tried to tell me that my son could not zip up his own coat. Mm. When at home,
he's zipping.
And I didn't understand. And so I was like, Elijah, zip your coat up. And he's zip.
Yeah.
And I was like, your inability.
I like that. I like that.
Your inability to do what you need to reach my child will not cause me to medicate.
Yes. And I love that you bring that up, because that is why it's so important to be intentional as a parent. Mm-hmm. So Senya, her birthday is September, October, November, 2 months after the cutoff. Mm-hmm, so whereas Isaiah is on the younger end of his class, she's on the older end because she had to wait a whole year.
Yes.
Well, you know, during the pre-pre-K and the pre-pre-K and all of that, I used to come to the teachers and say, can you move her up? Mm-hmm. Can you move her up? You know, because it was always that time where you could tell she outgrew.
Yep.
And so I remember, I can't remember the age, but I think this was going into maybe the 3-year-olds, perhaps the 4-year-olds, I can't remember. But they were like, well, you know, she doesn't do a lot of talking. I said, she doesn't have anybody to talk to. She's outgrown this grade.
Right.
Age grade, you know, this age group. And so they were like, well, she really doesn't do a lot of talking, but what we'll do is we'll give her a day in the other class. I said, yeah, give her a day. She gets to that class, she talking all over the place. I was like, I know my child.
You're right.
It'd be one thing if she wasn't talking at home to her brother or to us.
Right. I'm not in denial.
Right. Right. Exactly. You don't want to be in denial.
Right.
But when you see, you know, certain things, if you're not an intentional parent, you might go with it.
Right.
Like, yeah, we'll just let her stay. And then now she's not, he or she is not developing.
Right.
She ain't got nobody to talk to.
Yo, when I told them, and I'm talking to dad, right? And then so dad has his firstborn is autistic. Mm-hmm. So there's this stigma. Mm-hmm. And he's like, no, you don't let them label you because once you label and all this other stuff. Yeah. And I'm thinking, look, if they want to give him extra time and take him out of the class and all this stuff, I pulled him aside and I said, let me tell you something. There's nothing wrong with you.
Yeah.
You learn the way that you learn. Mm-hmm. You take as much time as you want to, because I know that when you're ready to come out here and play with us, right. You're going to take us all over, right?
Exactly.
And he was like, okay, Mom. I said, I don't care what you overhear other people say. I don't care what anybody says. You own the space that you're in, right? Mm-hmm. And he literally met one of the most amazing teachers, and she loved him so much and pumped him with, it was a blessing to be in that space. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, even where he is today, where he's like, Mom, some classes are too fast and some classes are too slow.
Yeah.
He's like, it's like, let me be me. Mm-hmm. Because that was instilled in him very, very early. But I had to sit down with him and have a conversation with him about, son, you're just not thinking.
Yeah,
why aren't you allowing yourself to think? And it was because of the thing being left back. And it came up that because he was left back, it did something to him. And I explained to him, you weren't left back because something was wrong with you. I believe as a parent, I started you in school too soon. Early. Mm-hmm. You weren't ready. And so honestly, you're exactly where you need to be. Without that conversation, the way he is showing up in the world today.
Oh my gosh, he is
based
everything.
Based on that conversation, oh my God, we have to talk to our kids.
Absolutely, 100%. I want to, you know, we've got the What Was Sensei coming up. But I want to, you said something, I wrote it down. I can't remember who you said it, but, Forrest Gump's mom.
Yeah.
You know, you don't let someone see you, blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to want to talk about that when we come back, more in relation to the fears we project on our children.
Ooh, projection.
Yes, I want to talk about that. But we've got the What Would Sensei coming up. Make sure you share, and stay tuned in. You're listening to The Unbroken Experience with Syndy B on Power 108.9. And we'll be right back.
Is there a family member or friend that you are aware of that is suffering in silence when it comes to her cycle? Justice for My Jewel has a new product that will minimize the cramps and kill 99.6% of the bacteria so that it effectively eliminates odor. The Justice for My Jewel campaign is about reducing these numbers through awareness and education. Please join their campaign and share this information with the women in your life at jfmj.org. For more information and to order today, go to painlesschoice.com or contact the Three Amigos at 470-387-1675. You will be comfortable and dry. The suffering in silence stops today, and tell them Syndy B sent them your way.
Yo, it's Michael McFadden for our friends over at Credit Building Professionals. You know what they do? They help their clients achieve better credit. How? late payments, fraud, liens, charge-off, student loans. They do it all. Get results in 30 to 90 days, and it's very simple to contact them. Hit them up on their website, creditbuildingprofessionals.com, or give them a call, 678-447-2012. Once again, 678-447-2012. Tell them you heard it on Power 108.9. What up, Credit Chris? Yo, looking for a new house? Then it's time for you to holler at our guy, the mortgage guy, Alvin Jameson of Loan Depot. Yo, it's your boy Michael McFadden of Mornings with Michael and Friends, and I tell you what, Alvin Jameson and the crew, they really do it all. First-time home buyers, refinances, investment properties, VA home loans too. Hit them up. It's very simple. AlvinJameson.com. Y'all know Alvin like the chipmunk. Jameson like that fine whiskey. You can also hit him up by mobile phone, 404-587-9033. Once again, 404-587-9033. Alvin Jameson, Loan Depot. Tell him you heard it on Power 108.9. What up, Alvin?
In a world of petty and immature people, it's refreshing to hear a morning show that has sophisticated hosts such as Michael McFadden and Jay Nash. Don't believe me? Take a listen.
But shout out to our friends over there at Credit Building Professionals. What up, Credit Crit?
I tried to come with you.
Yeah, thank you very much.
You're
That's
welcome.
What she said.
Ooh. Oh.
Hey. Power 108.9, a station for the people.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, from across the nation and around the world, your mentor, your coach, your sensei. Listen close. This is What Would Sensei?
Welcome back. You are listening to The Unbroken Experience with Syndy B on Power 108.9.
Yay, yay!
It is time for that What Would Sensei?
Yeah, yeah, yeah!
All right, Michael, what you got for us?
Hey, my husband is turning into a loser. This one-niner pandemic has left him working at home with literally no hobbies, friends, and he ain't even been taking no baths.
Dang.
He's been verbally abusive to me and angry. Our conversations get nowhere. But around and around, he's always attacking me. He's insecure, self-absorbed, and just a plain mean. Should I leave, or is there hope for change?
Matt, where you going?
It's a virus out there.
Baby, where you going?
Listen, in these corona times, it's never okay to be abusive. It's never okay to be mean and all those other things. Wise, make sure you handing out that pom-pom. You know, make sure you handing out that pom-pom.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because in these corona times, they need a little release. They need a little bit more release than they've been receiving.
Yeah.
You know, instead of just Saturday, they need Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. Yeah. So that's one. Two is that when you see him acting up, have a conversation with him. You know, I know you miss your boys. I know you miss these things. Is there something, you know, that I can do? Something I can help you? And if not, be gone. Get gone, you know? This is not the time to be, like, leaving your husband.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? We have to be understanding. Now, if you're being abused and those type of things,
that's
I'm pretty sure
story.
You was being abused before, you know, those type of things. That's a different story.
Right.
But if he's just missing his friends, you know what I'm saying? You know, you got to relax, relate, release a little
Agreed.
Bit.
Agreed. I 100% agree. And you never know. You know, men will not speak on depression, but that could definitely be. There are a lot of people that experience
that's
depression.
That's what it sounds like.
That's exactly what it sounds like. Don't be so hard on the fella.
Yeah.
You know.
Don't leave.
Don't leave
me,
him,
girl.
Hey, to all husbands and wives with children, you tell your child something and they roll their eyes at you and ignore you. What's the next move?
All right, Nat, communicator.
Well, first of all, we have to understand that just because we say something doesn't mean that every and anybody is going to agree with you. Like, we can't just react to our children like, oh, we're having pasta tonight. They had pizza on the brain. You know what I'm saying? And they roll their eyes and next thing you know, they got a concussion. They have the right to not agree with what it is that you're presenting. But what you can do is open up the opportunity for communication to be able to say, you're not feeling pasta, but it's everything is so personal. Like the eye rolling, you was looking. You wanted something. You wanted something to react to. You needed a release. Back up off them kids.
Listen, Linda. Isaiah and Senya. Okay. Y'all know how your mommy is built. And I am not built for the eye rolling and ignoring.
They don't want no pasta tonight.
I am here for the mommy, can we have something different? I am here for communication. I'm not here for disrespect.
That was communication.
Eye rolling is not.
Absolutely, they communicated to you that they did not want that.
Try it if you want to, because because it'd be one thing if in our house I did not promote communication, that I didn't have an open door.
That is communication.
That is not.
Yeah, absolutely.
That is body language.
That is and body language is communication.
I need words.
The words are, I don't want your dry pasta tonight.
Now listen, I'm all for communication.
They communicated. It went like this. Byron.
Try it if you want to, Isaiah and Senya.
You can roll your eyes, you can stamp your feet, but this pasta, you gonna eat.
You ain't gonna eat. Because you're going to bed. What you got next?
Somebody said, the husband said, wifey, your pasta is dry too. Fix that, please.
Husband rolling his eyes.
He was looking at the kids like, yes, kids, fight for your rights.
Yeah, but hubby not talk about that pasta.
Oh, you know
hey,
what?
Yeah.
You know what?
Oh, dang. You that's a whole nother set.
That's cold-blooded.
I'm sorry.
Cold-blooded.
All right, here we go. Y'all ready?
Ready.
All right, let's go. If your spouse vents to their friends about you all the time, how would you feel? Would you feel uncomfortable hanging out with them because they always hear negative things about you? Does that make sense?
Yes.
Or would you be okay because you know everyone vents and they won't look at you in a negative way because of the things that they've heard about you? Oh, my gosh. I want to chime in.
Right. Please chime in. Michael McFadden, what do you have to say?
All right, Natalie. Nat, come on.
First of all, first things first. If he's talking to them about you, that means that you are not a safe place
to talk to.
That's one. Mm-hmm. Number two, he don't want your panties in his pasta.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? So if you nasty, you're dirty, you got trifling ways. Come on now. You know you got trifling ways.
Yeah.
Your feelings is hurt because he's going and talking about your trifling ways. But he is the recipient of your nasty, a dirty, trifling way. He just need a little exhale. He need a little waiting to exhale with his people. Now, you are not feeling some type of way because of him. You're feeling some type of way because of you. Because nobody really taught you because you're trifling. And you don't know how to untrifling yourself. But here's the deal. You knew you was trifling.
And
you just
tacky.
Didn't.
You're just trifling and tacky.
But the problem is, but you married me and you knew I was trifling. So why not? Why are you now going to an outside source and telling them that?
You know what? So don't be talking about me to nobody. First of all, but I'm a safe place to talk to. So I agree with what you said. If you're not a safe place or he done told you ain't making no changes, he got to have an outlet somewhere.
You think he's like, hey, babe, can you not put your drawers in the pantry? And you keep putting it in the pantry.
I mean,
he's like, okay, cool. Because he brought it up because it was a problem. Where you think all of that went? Where do you think it went? So he go for the cereal and the oatmeal and your drawers is in the pantry.
But the fact that she knows that he's talking about, I don't even know. Let's
it's a whole lot, yeah.
Got a whole lot going on, ma'am.
All right, you ready for the last one?
I'm ready.
All right, I feel so embarrassed to ask, but is oral sex really normal? is it very important for men? I haven't done this for my husband, and I know he wants me to. Men, is this a necessity in your sex life? Would it make you love your wife more?
Michael McFadden.
What's the no? It's not important?
What's the answer?
He said no, it's not that important.
He said it's not important?
He said it's not that important. Oral sex is not that important.
Well, I subscribe to the you cannot ask a general question about your relationship.
Yes, agreed.
You need to talk. There are some things about your spouse that is 1, 2, 3.
Yeah.
And you put what you put as 3 might be a 1 for him. And so go open wide. The gate.
Agreed. I think it's to each relationship.
Yes.
You know, it might not be a big necessity to one relationship.
Did you say
necessity? Yep. Yep. It may not be a big necessity, okay? Yes. Okay?
Yes.
And? But no. But then, for yours, if he is constantly talking about it, like, hey, babe, ooh, this would be nice. I'm going to need you to go on and add that to the repertoire.
If he keep feeding you bananas, ma'am.
Ooh, these bananas are real ripe. Ooh, they real firm. To each their own. But you got to do what works for you. Yes, Michael.
You got a bonus question.
Okay, I'm ready.
Were you finished with your last one?
Yep.
What you looking at me? I'm sorry. it was on the same premise via social media.
Okay.
Do you do certain things? Well, let me rephrase it.
Okay.
I'm reading it. I want to paraphrase it. Okay.
I got you.
I feel uncomfortable doing things with my wife sexually.
Okay.
Is that uncommon?
Ooh. I don't think it's uncommon.
Okay.
I am of the belief that we start relationships wrong.
Okay.
We're talking about something 10 years later that should have been discussed before we even got married. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like, what's your appetite? And then, like, an employee appraisal, yearly, you need to, like, really have a conversation about where are you now. You might have taken a new job and you're, like, you're really accomplishing a lot of things. And it's like, you might think something is wrong with me, but I all of a sudden, where once or twice a week was okay,
it's
like I need to release and stuff like that. And so I just don't think in relationships we've done it right.
Yeah.
And so is it normal? It absolutely is normal to feel uncomfortable, but it is not okay to not communicate that with your spouse and make it a conversation.
I think there are some men in particular who don't like to do certain things that they may have done in their single days, you know, that they don't want to do to their wife, but their wife might feel a way about that. Like, why won't you do that to me?
But if you was the snack that smiles back then, and you want to withdraw your application for that after we've been married for 3-4 years, that could be a problem, especially to a woman, because they're immediately gonna make it emotional.
Sure.
And it just causes you guys have to communicate every step of the way.
Communicate. But I'll say this. You know, when it comes to my marriage, give me all the business. Okay, give me all the business. But dating, you can't just do any and everything to me. I'm sorry. You got to earn that. So I'm opposite. I know some men, when they get married, they're like, that's my wife. I put her up here. And so I don't want to do this. I don't want to do that. But that's when you should be able to do all of that.
And, you know, I got jumped last year because, you know, people got issues with me saying what I say. But at the end of the day, sometimes, you know, like men, I've realized that they real simple. You let them bust all over your face one good time, or you let them do something one good time, like that one thing you're withholding, like just
like,
one good time.
7 years.
Seven years, and then like bad credit, it drops off, and they're like, wait, you never did that.
All right, y'all, that's that What Would Sin Say. When we come back, we're going to get back into our Family Matters, Breaking the Silence. conversation. Make sure you are sharing. If you heard me, please share, share, share the love. And stay tuned in. You're listening to The Unbroken Experience with Syndy B on Power 108.9. And we'll be right back.
And it is now my great honor to introduce the President-elect of the United States of America, Joe Biden.
Yo, it's Michael McFadden for our friends over at Credit Building Professionals. You know what they do? They help their clients achieve better credit. How? Late payments, fraud, liens, charge-off, student loans. They do it all. Get results in 30 to 90 days, and it's very simple to contact them. Hit them up on their website, creditbuildingprofessionals.com, or give them a call, 678-447-2012. Once again, 678-447-2012. Tell them you heard it on Power 108.9. What up, Credit Craig?
What's up, family? I call you family because I feel like we can be honest with each other. Nowadays, we all got side hustles and businesses. And in a gig economy, we're all looking for ways to expand our clientele. Power up with 108.9's advertising partnership. Connect to over 100,000 viewers per month. If you're interested, contact our marketing director at thepower108.9@gmail.com. Help us reach your target audience and expand your brand. Power 108.9, the station for the people.
Is there a family member or friend that you are aware of that is suffering in silence when it comes to her cycle? Justice for My Jewel has a new product that will minimize the cramps and kill 99.6% of the bacteria so that it effectively eliminates odor. The Justice for My Jewel campaign is about reducing these numbers through awareness and education. Please join their campaign and share this information with the women in your life at jfmj.org. For more information and to order today, go to painlesschoice.com or contact the Three Amigos at 470-387-1675. You will be comfortable and dry. The suffering in silence stops today, and tell them Syndy B sent them your way.
Everybody been waiting on that baby, man.
Welcome back. You're listening to the Unbroken Experience with Syndy B on Power 108.9. I've got my girl, my co-host in the building, Miss Natalie Fikes. Say hey to the folks.
Say hey to the folks. Everybody know that. Different folks, different strokes.
Them folks. All right. You ready to get jump back into this conversation?
Let go.
Before what was Sensei, I wanted to get into that conversation of you had brought up in the conversation with what's his name?
Elijah.
Forrest Gump. Mama.
Yes.
You don't let them do this. You don't let them do that. Mm-hmm. And before I get into the fears as parents, what we project onto our children, mm-hmm. I want to say I am that parent with the don't you let them see you sweat. Mm-hmm. Don't you let them see you cry. You cry to me, mm-hmm. You know, it's okay to cry. Like I'm all with that. But I am that parent that says you don't let them see you sweat. What are your thoughts on that?
I think that even when I said don't let anybody make you feel slow or any of that type of stuff, that I really could have said, what do you think about yourself? Mm-hmm. I think that's the most important thing, is how do you see yourself?
Yeah.
And before we ask that question, we put so much of don't do this and this is how you. What we set them up for is to put a wall up. Mm-hmm. Instead of being honest and true in the moment, mm-hmm. even in our best intentions. The very first question we really should ask our children is, what do you think about yourself?
Mm-hmm. Now, I'm with that. I'm with our conversation, right?
Yeah.
But the way that the world is set up.
Still.
I am not for, and I don't see that changing. I am not for either my daughter or my son in a situation at school saying to someone who tried to lame them out in front of somebody else or embarrass them or something like that, like, you know what? That really hurt my feelings. Like, I'm not with that. I am not with that. Now, I'm with them coming home and saying, you know what, Mom, this is what happened. It really did hurt my feelings. And then from there, I'm like, okay, but why?
I see what you're saying. So for listen, I wasn't trained and I just made it up along the way.
Sure.
What I do in setting my kids up for the world is if I feed them the language.
Yes.
The language.
Yes.
And so what would you do if you were in a situation XYZ?
Yes.
And then they would give me what their response would be. And then I would say, then, well, what happens if they do this?
Mm-hmm.
And then we would go all the way through it until we get to a dead end.
That's what I'm with.
Yes.
That's what I'm with. That's the kind of conversations that I have.
Yes.
I'll bring up all kinds of scenarios, whether it's scenarios with a friend that did something that you didn't expect. Because my kids, they're raised to have their people's back.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So if they see something outside of that, it bothers them. Like they don't really get that. Like, I thought we was people, you know, kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a reality.
Mm-hmm.
So I feed them situations. Okay, well, what if? Yeah, I know that's your homegirl. I know that's your homeboy. But what if? Blah,
what if
blah,
they
blah.
Rob in a convenience store?
Yes.
What you gonna do in that situation?
Yes. Mm-hmm. All kinds of things. Or what if? Because you know, my son had a scenario with one of his really good friends, and I think it was something along the lines of, sometimes they have their own friends outside. And so if said friend feels like they have to act a certain way and is different than what you're used to, okay, well, what you going to do
right.
with that? Because you know that's your homeboy, right?
Well, so we project a lot. Mm-hmm. Like, even when you're explaining, that's a lot of you that you're projecting
Absolutely.
Onto your child. It's a projection. But not all projections are negative or unhealthy.
Yeah.
You understand?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so that's really what we need to process.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I am built on asking questions.
Mm-hmm.
I sit in the space of asking questions. Like with the younger one, he has this one boy on the game who is rude and mean, and he lashes out on him when he doesn't do what he wants him to do.
Yes.
And then so I ask him, how does that make you feel? And then to me, he expresses how he really feels. But then when he shows up to him, he's forgiving him and all that other stuff. I am not built like that.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And so I had to catch myself in projecting onto him, like, you put these boundaries in place. And instead, because I saw this thing in his eye where I could absolutely do what you're telling me to do, but that's not
but
my
I don't
truth.
Want to.
That's not my truth.
Okay.
And so I am mad as hell.
Right.
But I can tell that he is forgiving and he is forgiving. And so I asked him, where's the line? What does he need to do to show you what he's already showing you what he's capable of?
Yeah.
What does he need to do in order for you to just say, I'm done with you? And what he showed me was a capacity that far outweighed my own.
Yeah.
And it's a capacity where it really taught me to be mindful.
Which son is this?
This is the younger one.
Yeah, yeah. He reminds me so much of Isaiah.
Yeah.
He really does.
And you would think that he was, because he, no cut cards.
Yep.
He does not play, especially when it comes to adults, because he is so aware and just at a level. He does not play when it comes to adults, but with young people.
Yeah,
he just lets all types of things slide.
So that's like with Isaiah. So he has this, I call him an associate, because he ain't never been to the house. So
you ain't cool with me.
Okay. So, but I know that, you know, they play the games together and that whole online thing or whatever, but he's a little bit extra for me. You know, the friend is a bit much for me.
Uh-huh.
Okay. so I, one day, I don't know what was happening. I was like, they. He's a lot, mm-hmm. you know, and da 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 da. And then he's like, but mommy, he's fine. Like, he's fine. And so I had to say, I'll be like, okay. You know, but for me, it's a lot, you know. But I have to let him, because I know what I do know that I teach my children. They know their capacity.
Yes.
They do know their capacity, and they will end it, mm-hmm. or they will take a break. They will take a fallback, and then a lot of times that's when I step up, when it's a really good friend mm-hmm. that I know that they've been friends with. I mean, they're still young, but they have friends that they've been friends with since they were 2-3 years mm-hmm. old. And so if it's a good friend, and I know that they're just doing those growing pains, and that's when I step in to teach yeah. my children. And then, because if you're a good friend to my children, I'm around you. Mm-hmm. And so I'll teach them both how to be good friends to each other. Mm-hmm. And I also think that's a missing piece in parenting.
Oh, absolutely.
With teaching your children, number one, how to be a good friend.
How are you going to teach what you don't know, though?
Man, but
because some of these hot mess adults, you was a ratchet, trifling friend when you were young.
Because you weren't taught.
And because you were not taught, and there were no boundaries, and everybody played with you because XYZ.
Right.
Now you grow up never having been taught, and now you are ratchet, trifling, crybaby friend.
Right.
And now we got to deal with that as an adult.
Yeah.
And then crazy, ratchet, crybaby, trifling adults who have children are now the parents in the PTO.
They are the epitome. They are the picture of their parent. I have seen that.
Satan's nutsack. Mm. I'm telling you right now. Mm-mm. You never learned it. And then your kids are, it is horrible to watch.
Yeah.
But what I know is that my children, like Elijah, is going to just take it and take it and take it and implode and implode and implode. That Elijah.
Okay.
This guy today, he's literally like, you know, you talk a lot about yourself. And that's probably why. And you know, I'm not enjoying this experience. He is very much his mother in that space, because we talk about it, and I airdrop. I don't say anything. Mm-hmm. And then we talk during our time. Mm-hmm. Jaden, he is the type of person where he wants friends, but he's like, I don't deal with, he is very clear that he does not deal with kids his age.
Okay.
He said, I am more interested in older women.
Excuse me.
He either going to have a cougar or I have to prepare myself for this. He is so absolutely clear. He said these young girls are very disrespectful and that they don't listen mm-hmm. and those type of things. He said, Mom, what I really want is a guy friend
okay.
that we can just be friends.
Okay.
I just want us to play. Okay. I don't want you to try to expose me to anything.
Yeah.
I don't want you to try to, you know, any. I just want to play. I want a homeboy, and he is very business oriented. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And he's like, let's build together. Very much that part of me.
Yeah.
And so when I'm saying cut him off.
Yeah.
He's not that person, and to not project onto him.
Yeah, I think about a scenario, and then I want to get into the black sheep of the family.
Ooh, bad.
I think about my daughter. She has this friend that I really like. I really like her. She hasn't been around a lot, as long as some of the others, but I like her. But when they start, with the quarantine and the pandemic, when that first started, they were on the phone a lot because that's all they could do, right? And this particular young lady
that I like.
Okay, now I do like her. If Syn didn't answer her phone, she blew her up.
Oh.
Blew her up.
And that's a no for you in real life.
In real life. Y'all Woo! Know, if y'all know me, I don't like no smothering situation, number one. Number two, then when Syn did finally, Syn probably downstairs doing something
it's
else.
The,
you know,
where was you at? But.
When she would answer, she'd be like, and she would be upset. And she would be upset with Syn. And then, like, kind of give her attitude. And so I did step in this time to show her, like, because I wouldn't make her cut her off or anything, but I said, that is not how a friend behaves. Mm-hmm. I said, so tell her, because I wanted her friend to know that she has a parent that's watching mm-hmm. and that's paying attention. And so I said, tell her that your mom said, we're going to take a little break mm-hmm. because that's not how friends treat each other. Mm-hmm. And well, you'll talk tomorrow. Mm-hmm. And it was early in the day, mm-hmm. early. It was like 11, 12. And so later on in the day, then Sin was like, mommy, but can I talk to her, please? And I said, okay, as long as I can trust that you are able to communicate, because Sin didn't like it. She was like, oh. She's calling me again, but I'm trying to do X, Y, Z.
Right.
And so I said, as long as I can trust that you will always speak up for yourself, mm-hmm. you know, because I can't always
I won't
be
have
there.
To intervene.
Yeah, I don't want to do that. But, you know, there's certain times when you're in the teaching.
Yes.
You know, and I had there was no problems after that. Mm-hmm. And sometimes, you know, when you have friends and you're the parent, you got to take them both under your wing sometimes, because I do know that they're in a lot of parenting, friendships is at the lowest.
Absolutely.
Teaching how to be a friend.
Yes.
I guess. They want friends and they want their kids to have friends. But teaching how to be a friend and teaching how to, you're teaching your child how to create boundaries within your mm-hmm. friends is on the, not even, sometimes mostly it's not on, even on the radar.
It's not even on the radar because they don't know how to do it.
Yeah.
That is what we're dealing with. I don't know what fairy dust we got. Because mm-hmm. we get it.
Yeah.
And we can talk about it all day and people are listening like, wow, that's so awesome. That is so cool. I wish I could do it. But at the end of the day, it's you have to do the work mm-hmm. to figure out and find out what you need to do, because you're just handing down your toxic behavior to your children. And somewhere along the line, we were like, it's a no. But we do have to take into consideration that our kids are not us and their capacities are different.
Yeah.
And once we introduce them to their capacity, like when you said Sin is like, I don't even like it.
Yeah.
That is when we need to talk about it. When they're like, I don't see a problem with it. We can't project that on them.
But I will let them know, like, I couldn't do it.
That ain't.
But go ahead, Dale.
Right, you know?
I do.
And then when they get to that point where it now becomes a problem,
they
that's when you interject.
Yep.
That
exactly.
part. Yeah.
All right, so I want to get into this. I don't want this time to go by and we don't talk about, when it comes to family matters and breaking the silence, the black sheeps of the family. And do you think that comes with what we talked about earlier, the lack of communication, the lack of understanding your child, you know, and all the things, you know, along those lines. And I'm going to save the other one.
Be a good mother. I'm trying to cater to my husband. I'm trying to help my family. I'm just tired, yo. Everybody pulling from me from different directions, and I'm just tired. Not enough sleep. I can sleep for a month and still would be tired.
This is Tammy.
Waka Flocka's wife.
Yes. You know her from Housewives, Love and Hip Hop Atlanta.
And Meet the Flockas or
The spinoff. Mm-hmm. You know, I've been there. I've been there, and it makes me think of, as children in our generation, I feel like a lot of moms were going through that, but you weren't supposed to speak of it.
You can't express that back then. Mm-hmm. And so here are the things that we never talked about. And that's why the black sheep is like, I hate you.
Yeah.
It's not okay to beat on my mother. Mm-hmm. It's not okay for you to rape us. Mm-hmm. It's not okay for you to beat us. It's not okay for you to steal, and I know you stole, and we all getting beaten. Mm-hmm. And you sit there and act like it wasn't you. It's not okay for you to put the whole entire family through all of this stuff, mm-hmm. and everybody is focusing on you, and everybody else is being ignored.
Yeah.
It's not okay. Mm-hmm. It's not okay for you to leave and be gone, and I'm raising your children.
Yeah.
That's the number one issue, I believe, that we have in our society right now. And when you look at a man or a woman and you're like, they're not taking care of their kids, you know why? Because the 10 years when they were supposed to be a child,
they were taking care
of somebody else's child. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So now their child gets there and they are all worn out. Tired. I got to do this for this person. I got to do this for that person. I was the one who came into the family and was more enlightened as to how to get us out of here. And now that I am at a place where it's separate from what we've been through, now everybody wants to ride my back.
Right.
You know, I know I literally got addicted to being broke for a few years because I've always had money. Mm-hmm. I was in corporate America in high school.
Right.
But I realized that when you're the one that have, when you have, everybody is calling you. Nobody sees you. Nobody hears you. They just always have their hand out. Mm-hmm. And so when I stepped away from my big time job and I was just a regular person working in cosmetology, you know, you would think it would all go away. Mm-hmm. But no, but because you're the person that's always going and driving and getting it and everything, people always have their hands out. Mm-hmm. And so when I started my youth organization, I actually fell in love with giving money away.
Okay.
As long as y'all keep showing up, I will make sure we have food. We'll go on trips. We'll do this and all. And I fell in love with how that. What I was doing with my money because my introduction to money was you have it, so you give it to people who ain't working. You give it to people who ain't trying. You give it to people who are already always in need. And I got so sick and tired of that that I just was, even when I could see that the balances were getting lower, 401k, all of those things, it didn't matter to me because of how I was using my money to do what I wanted to do.
Would you say that you were using your money to do what you wanted to do, or were you filling a void?
I was using my money to do what it was my introduction to money and me actually enjoying. I didn't enjoy paying bills. I did it because it was what you were supposed to do. I didn't enjoy somebody calling me and saying they needed $1,000 and giving it to them because I felt sorry for them. Right. I enjoyed taking these young people on trips. I enjoyed paying for CPR classes. I enjoyed feeling for something that their parents couldn't do for them.
Okay.
And it was for the advancement of them getting somewhere. Not you didn't take care of your life and your responsibilities.
And now it's on me.
And so if I go back as a child and I understand that me and my mother, the reason why we were so, I was the black sheep to her.
Okay.
It was difficult because.
How were you the black sheep to her?
Because we, you know, we always want to do this women empowerment thing. I will put a clear line of demarcation between you and me if you on the other side of what I'm about to say, because all women are not created equal.
Yeah.
Okay. And so me and my mother have always been a different kind of woman.
Okay.
She's the type of woman that will use you. She's the type of woman that will play victim when she's the one that started the whole situation. She's the type of woman that will misappropriate her funds and lie about it. As a child, I could look and I could tell. I'd be like, I would say stuff and then everything that I would say, it was like my presence was an issue to her. And I will never forget my introduction to money. I wanted an encyclopedia so bad. Oh my God, if you had an encyclopedia, you was doing something,
yes,
okay? I wanted an encyclopedia so bad. And so after nagging and nagging and nagging and nagging, she finally let the encyclopedia people come to the house. Finally, it was like the Kirby people, right? She finally let them come to the house. And when they gave her that price, she was like, it's a whole hell no in my shanana, right? She like, no, right? And what she said to me, I'm like, Mom, are we getting the encyclopedia? And she said, no, we're not going to get it. Like, it costs too much money. Like, no, why would we spend money on that? And I will never forget, because she wasn't the type of person to go shopping or buy me things. Like, I had to need it, like holes in it to get it.
Yeah.
And I'd never forget, we had went shopping after that.
Oh.
My understanding of money was like, you don't pay for education. You don't pay for these type of things. All you do is you pay for food. Mm-hmm. You pay for clothes. You pay for shelter.
Hey.
But as a child, there was something in me that understood that you use your money to get something you don't actually have or know. Mm-hmm. And I knew she wasn't giving me what I needed, so my cry was for that. And so it's really sad that you're only stuck with at the ceiling of whoever your parents are.
Yeah.
And their resources are your resources. Mm. And, you know, it was like I was she could not stand my presence because there was something about my presence.
When did you know that she couldn't stand your presence?
It was really when I was older. Uh-huh. Yeah, I didn't know as a child. I didn't understand. I was very curious. I was always.
Why do you think?
It was oppression. It was what she came out of. And the little bits of her story. Mm-hmm. This is why me and her don't rock right now. Mm-hmm. It's because you hold history for me that you're not willing to talk about because of your own issues.
Yeah.
And because of that, if that's the case, we not going to sit here in silence when I'm here dying.
Yeah. So I remember when I found my birth mother in my early 20s. So my mommy, everybody knows my mommy. She's listening tonight. That is my mommy, and that's it. That period, okay? But I do have a birth mother that I was not raised with. And when I discovered her, I wasn't looking for a mom. I was looking for my history. And she wasn't trying to give me that because of her upbringing. Her childhood experience was very traumatic, and I understand that, you know, with the bits that I've been able to put together over the years.
Mm-hmm.
And I get that.
I get it.
But I ain't got nothing to do with that. Okay? And we grown. And you should understand that there's history that she doesn't understand.
Mm-hmm.
So you know how that makes you feel, right? That you don't understand certain things. And the reason why we couldn't have a relationship is because I wasn't seeking a mom. I have a mommy.
Mm-hmm.
I was seeking history.
History.
And because you don't give me that.
What? You got one job. You got one job.
Just one.
And when you no call, no show.
Yeah.
You get fired from that job.
Yes.
And so what's deep about it is that, and a lot of people carry that stuff. There's so many loyalties to our mothers and our fathers and things of that nature.
Mm-hmm.
I am very clear. I read The Purpose-Driven Life, and it was something that talked about your parents really were the vehicle that got you here.
Sure.
And so I'm like, because you were the Uber that gave me a lift, does not mean that my loyalty lies with you. You didn't raise me. You didn't teach me. You didn't do any of those things. All I'm asking you for, boo, is to just give me a little piece of parts of my memory and history that I cannot remember so I can try to figure out Natalie and make a life for myself. Yes. And if you can't do that, what you here for?
What's because at
the end of the day, you never really sat down and was like, I want to have this daughter, and I'm going to make her nose this way, and I'm going to make her eyes this way, and I'm going to make her brain this way, and all this other stuff. You was bumping and grinding with my daddy, and a baby showed up.
Yeah.
And so if you can't, you didn't raise me, you didn't teach me, you didn't do all those things, and all I'm asking for.
Just give me.
Give me a little piece.
Yeah, give me a little something.
And if you can't, I don't feel obligated. Right. And so I told my brother and my sister, because I was an only child for 13 years. And so by the time they're young, I'm out because I moved out at 16. I was out in high school figuring it out. So I wouldn't kill nobody.
Right.
OK. And so I told my brother and sister very early, while my mother is fine and fit and fabulous and all that other stuff, when the phone call comes that she not all right, don't call my phone first. She actually raised y'all. She actually raised y'all. Make me be the last phone call that y'all make because she actually raised y'all. Because at the end of the day, I do not feel obligated to strokes that you was enjoying with my daddy when the obligation got here and you did not take care of me. I honor you and I will send a check, mm-hmm, mm-hmm, but I am not stopping my life because you did. Honor is a totally different thing from like you getting to participate in my day-to-day life. Yeah. You did not work for that. Mm-hmm. Mommy worked for that.
Yeah.
People I met on the street worked for that.
Right.
But you didn't work for that, and I feel nothing.
Yeah.
I'm not hurt. I'm not bitter. I'm not bruised. Mm-hmm. I just believe that if you didn't sow, you shouldn't reap.
100%. But I like the honor part.
It's honor.
I like the honor part.
I'm sending checks like Tyler Perry, but you don't get to come and chill at the kids' basketball games and the birthdays and all that other stuff necessarily. If you want to
if you planting seeds and you and
that part
and you feeding that and you feeding that part. The crops. You feeding the, you know, the soil.
You don't just
and
get
stuff.
To show up with a title.
No, but you're gonna, you can never compare and you can never make up.
Nah.
But if you planting seeds
now
and
in today
and you're consistently nourishing that soil, then we can talk. But I like that honor part. Mm-hmm. We're gonna take a little break.
I still need my history though.
Yes, I deserve
it. I need my history.
And I'm always going to feel away until I get it.
And so you could go sit down. Somewhere.
So sit down. Okay. So when we come back, I want to talk about apologizing as a parent.
Ooh.
We ain't get that. Love you though, Ma. We ain't get that. And I want to be able to talk about because, and this could be a whole nother conversation, but colorism within our community. The light skin and light skin and dark skin within the black community and our families and how that shows up. I wanted to be able to talk about that earlier because I know that's a part of different cultures, not just the black community. But I want to talk about that and apologizing as a parent. Do you apologize when you make a mistake? We're going to talk about that when we come back. You're listening to The Unbroken Experience with Syndy B on Power 108.9. And we'll be right back.
If you hadn't made your way over to power108.9.com, you're just as bad as the people who didn't vote in this year's election.
The votes are still coming in. I'm going to give you a list of states that I'm never visiting, ever.
Oh, never, ever, ever.
Y'all state. I'm sorry, did I just cut?
You just cut.
I dropped the F-bomb, didn't I?
Straight. My early bad. In the morning.
Power 108.9, a station for the people.
What's up, family? I call you family because I feel like we can be honest with each other. Nowadays, we all got side hustles and businesses. And in a gig economy, we're all looking for ways to expand our clientele. Power up with 108.9's advertising partnership. Connect to over 100,000 viewers per month. If you're interested, contact our marketing director at thepower1089@gmail.com. Help us reach your target audience and expand your brand. Power 108.9, the station for the people. Tired of all that baloney.
Yo, it's Michael McFadden for our friends over at Credit Building Professionals. You know what they do? They help their clients achieve better credit. How? Late payments, fraud, liens, charge-offs, student loans. They do it all. Get results in 30 to 90 days, and it's very simple to contact them. Hit them up on their website, creditbuildingprofessionals.com, or give them a call, 678-447-2012. Once again, 678-447-2012. Tell them you heard it on Power 108.9. What up, Credit Crit?
Question, who has an idea for a new app? Well, if you answer yes to that question, it's time for you to holler at our friends over at Appsketeers. Yo, it's Michael McFadden of Power 108.9, and the crew over at Appsketeers will take great care of you. Nick and the gang provide you with the all-in-one app development experience. We're talking design, UI, UX, coding, and a whole bunch more. And if you have no clue what that means, it's time for you to holler at Appsketeers. Check out the website, appsketeers.com. Now,
man. We're talking full confidentiality, no hassle, no obligation. If you don't believe me, just call them. 833-APP-IDEA. That's 833-APP-IDEA. As a matter of fact, you know what they do? They design, they build, and they launch. Tell them you heard it on Power 108.9. And don't forget to ask for the governor. What up, Nick?
Welcome back. Okay. You're listening to The Unbroken Experience with Syndy D on Power 108.9. I got my girl, my co-host in the building, Miss Natalie Fikes. Say hey to the people.
Natalie Fikes in the building.
We have been having a real great conversation about family matters, breaking the silence. I think I'm gonna table the colorism talk.
Okay.
Because that is a conversation by itself, but a very necessary conversation when it comes to families and family dynamics. But I want to get into the conversation when we're talking about communication and a child's place and all of that. Apologizing. I know how you operate, so I was getting ready to ask you. But let's talk about apologizing as a parent. What apologies would you have liked to have received as a child?
Everything.
Everything, I tell you.
Everything. A child is is the recipient. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And for anything to be the child's fault, mm-hmm. for a child to ever feel as though they were the cause of something, to me is just absolutely unhealthy. Mm-hmm. And I literally felt like my presence mm-hmm. was a problem. And it's just not okay for a child to feel that way.
Yeah.
Because what I now know, and I've gone through the healing process from a place of compassion, mm-hmm. because I now understand, because I'm a woman and I'm a mother, and it's real.
Yeah.
And them due dates come around real quickly. Mm-hmm. And I also believe that, you know, my mom was like a Christian hoe. You know mm-hmm. what I'm saying? Like, she had secret things and stuff that she was trying to fulfill, and what people told her she should be, and trying to carry all that stuff. Mm-hmm. And now that I see, like, I've seen my mother show up in friends. Mm-hmm. I've seen my mother show up in women that I've observed.
Okay.
And I understand. And it's from a great place of compassion, because I don't struggle with the same thing that you struggle mm-hmm. with. And that's not my thing. I have my thing, but that wasn't my thing.
Right.
But as a child to have received all of that, it mm-hmm. was not okay. Mm. But my mother even said to me, she was like, "You were the test dummy." And she said to me, it set me free. She said, "I was an angry black woman."
Wow.
And when she said that to me, it did something to me. Mm-hmm. She never apologized.
Sure.
She never said those things. And so you got to get what you can get. Mm-hmm. And I took that as an apology.
Yeah.
I wish she would have said to me, "I should not have said that. I should have not have done that." Because the way I show up to my kids, mm-hmm. I have boohooed so many times to my son.
Mm-hmm. I'm like, everything I'm doing is for you guys, and I promise you, I should not be taking this long to get there, but nobody taught me. I should not be doing it. If I would have known, I know I'm taking y'all through a lot of stuff. I know I'm doing all this other stuff, but I promise you, we almost there. I'm getting it. I'm learning it. I'm understanding it, and I'm sorry. I know you need me for this, and I know you need me for that, but I don't know. I didn't know. Mm. I've cried to my kids, and I'm like, what you're asking me for and what you're asking me to do, I don't have the capacity for. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Nobody taught me. I've said to them, like, I want to punch you in the face. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I know that's not going to be okay.
Right.
So I'm going to go in my room and I'm going to close my door and stay away from me until I come out, because I'm not okay. Uh-huh. And if I ever do this to you, you leave. You run. You leave the house, because I'm not okay. And my whole parenting mm-hmm. is based on apologies.
Sure.
Because I know
when I don't know. And I am not going to pretend that I know. I need you to know. Don't come to me for that.
Yeah.
So you could go get it if I can't give it for you.
I'm thankful. When I was pregnant with Isaiah, it changed my life. If you read any of my posts for National Sons Day or his birthday, or you just be around me with Isaiah, I always say he was sent here to save my life.
For real.
And when I say save my life, save me from myself.
For real.
And I remember being pregnant with him, and something, it just clicked. It changed. Because then I was surviving. I was angry.
Mm-hmm.
I was surviving. Just the thought of it. Just the thought of it, I feel heavy.
Yeah.
Of the space I was in. But when I was pregnant with him, I got to a place where I said, you have to heal now.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to... Mm. You have to seek the apologies or at least the acknowledgement from whomever you need it from. Mm. And because my mindset was, I will not bring this child into this world below ground zero.
Mm-hmm.
I will bring him into this world at ground zero. So if he does not succeed, it is not on me. It is not what I've placed on him.
Mm-hmm.
It is not mommy's baggage, mommy's drama, mommy's what she didn't heal from that I'm putting on him that will give him an excuse to not succeed.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And I'm thankful for my parents. I didn't have relationship baggage.
Mm-hmm.
Like, yeah, my feelings might have been hurt here and there, but I didn't. That's not where mine came from. But I'm thankful for my parents. Because I remember what I was wearing, jeans and my favorite white sweater at that time, belly sticking out, and having a conversation in my parents' room about a lot of things, some things they didn't even know that I knew, you know, but it helped them understand, you know, as a child, what I saw, what I observed, and what I took in, and how it affected me in my adult life. And I appreciate them talking to me, because not everybody gets that.
Yeah.
And that was a gift that I appreciate. I didn't get my dad, he was just apologizing. Oh, yeah, I'm sorry, baby girl. Yeah, to speak, baby girl. You know, like he was here for it, you know. But some apologies I didn't get just because maybe I didn't ask for an apology because maybe I didn't.
And they didn't know they needed to.
Yes. But more, I just needed acknowledgement.
Yes.
I needed acknowledgement that, you know what, Sin? You held it down. I remember asking my mom one time, you know what? I was here in Atlanta at 17 years old, literally on my own. And I don't think that you would have ever sent my younger sister out here. Like, why would you send me, not send me, but why was I out here kind of fending for myself, you know? And I don't think that you would have done Cheryl like that. And my mommy said to me, we just always knew that you would make it.
Yes.
And it did so much for me because I was angry about that. Like, y'all just left me out here. I'm out here surviving. I'm figuring out. I'm trying to pay bills and I'm trying to be in school at the same time. I have no tools, no knowledge, no understanding.
I have observed you and I know that you are that kid that no matter what happens, you're going to be okay.
Yeah.
And that's the black sheep.
Yeah.
That's the one that your Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer is your gift.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What has set you apart? Cheryl need a little bit more help. We got to put all that on. And it's like, but I need too. And it's like, baby, you're going to be all right. Cheryl need the help.
Yeah.
And it's hard. It's hard to be in that position.
Yeah.
And as parents, that should never be the case.
It shouldn't be. But I appreciated the acknowledgement that, we were overwhelmed as a couple, or we were overwhelmed individually, or whatever is going on at work, or as you know, my younger sister who is a cancer survivor, you know, all of that. They're like, look, we can only put our attention but
what
so many places.
I have so much so much compassion for that generation.
Yes, yes, but it did so much for me. To hear that, because it took a lot of anger away, and that's
acknowledgement
what
does that.
Yes,
and
yes.
And so as parents, if that's all we do is acknowledge,
yes, Sometimes that goes a long way. Hit us with the truth, no chaser.
So here's the deal. You can you were bumping and grinding as a person. Mm-hmm. And as you bumped and grind, it now promoted you to this position called parent, mm-hmm. that you had absolutely no manual for.
Yeah.
You are doing the very best that you know to do for yourself. Mm-hmm. But what I would ask of you is to not put yourself off the hook. Let yourself off the hook. Understanding that bringing another human being into the world is a responsibility that surpasses anything you could ever do in life.
Right.
And so it has to be intentional. It absolutely has to be intentional. And while you should not pressure yourself, you should absolutely look at your child and say, okay, what do I want for this child? What does this child want for themselves? Mm-hmm. Themselves. And understand that you can never want for your child more than they want for themselves. Mm-hmm. And if you're not present to actually see who that child is, if you're not communicating with that child to find out what's inside of them, what seed you're actually watering,
right.
You could actually be damaging them.
100%.
So slow down. Take a step back. Release yourself from everything that everyone has told you about what you should do as a parent. And just be 100% present with your child. Mm-hmm. Not trying to make up for your stuff. None of that. Just sit with them and ask them, what do you want? Mm-hmm. Who are you? What am I doing that affects you? What do you like and dislike about mm-hmm. being my child? Like, get inside of that child and understand them. And I promise you that the bond that you will create with your child will release you from so much of this parent woo-woo stuff mm-hmm. that we have put in place, and you will connect on a level that fulfills you and makes you feel like the Martin Luther King of your family.
Right.
That's true. No chaser.
I love it. Tell everyone where they can find you on social media.
Look, follow the bald head and the big smile. Okay. I am Natalie Fikes everywhere.
Yes, you are. Yes, and at all times.
At all times.
And you all know where you can find me, the Syndy B. Spell my name right. Huh. S-Y-N-D-Y. TheCindyB.com, as well as on Instagram and Facebook is TheCindyB as well. And you know you can find me here every single week, Thursdays at 7 o'clock p.m., The Unbroken Experience with Syndy B on Power 108.9. And I'll see you next week.